We had, I think in the end, about 4 months to produce just under 8,000 or 9,000 costumes.
And there were certainly times when the workload was very heavy. I mean, I can remember working through the night on several occasions to get costumes ready for the next morning for the shooting. And literally, I'd still be stitching on beads and bits of braid and, you know, right up to the last moment as it was being sort of taken out of the door.
It was a nightmare and great fun. The clothes for even principal characters were often done at the very last minute and had to be sort of improvised out of anything that was around.
The Sadikar, for instance, they wore this specific type of mask with this breathing apparatus on. The actual breathing apparatus was, you know, car hoses, you know, anything we could find.
Everyone thinks that movies are prepared for months, it's all carefully thought about. Often it's just off the top of your head at the last minute in, you know, whatever time you can get it done in. The scene where Sting wears that sort of wing jock strap, that was slated to be shot nude, and Sting agreed to do it nude, but the studio at the last minute panicked and thought they couldn't have Sting in the nude. So literally, I think at midnight the night before, they rang me up and said, you've got to put him in something. So we made this little winged G-string thing, and so it was ready the next morning for him to shoot on, so he wouldn't be actually nude. The Guild Navigators look very sinister and strange. And the reason they look sinister and strange is that the San Diego Fire Department was tearing down one of its old fire stations, and at the back they'd found all these 19, I think they were actually 20s, 30s and 40s, body bags, used body bags. And they were large canvas tarpaulings with all these cross-banded webbing straps on, and they were painted with tar. And when we undid them, they were, you know, they were bits of bodies, not actual bits of bodies, but, you know, fluids, and they weren't very pleasant. I didn't tell them until they'd finished that they actually were used body bags. The Baron's world was all based on industrial wear, or protective industrial wear, because, you know, I figured that that was a polluted environmental place. It was essential that Ken McMillan looked heavy. I mean, he was a well-built man, but I would say he was under 200 pounds, and we had to make him look as though he was 500 pounds. When Ken put it on, he couldn't stand up. I mean, it was too much weight for him to stand up. So we had a harness built underneath, and we made a metal A-frame, and he was wheeled around the studio to do shots and hooked onto his flying wire. So he never stood up in that suit ever. He was always hanging in it. It was very funny. One of the most interesting things about designing Dune was the solving the still suit. You know, the still suit is the essential, you know, central thing of the movie. And to me, it seemed that it should have a sort of futuristic Aboriginal quality. So they were almost tribal. And every single suit was handmade.
We had to do body casts from which we made fiberglass forms. And then from there, we would draw the pattern in chalk on the unitard and start cutting from the patterns of each foam rubber section, laid them on one by one until we got all the understructure built, including the tubing. We would brush coat it then with a thick latex and then spray coat it with another thinner latex for a final seal. At that point, put it in an oven where it would just kind of help the latex dry.
The women had to obviously have breasts rather than sort of pecs. And so I did a sort of a female version, and we did children's versions of it too.
They were really quite comfortable. Until, of course, you got them out of the hot sun in the desert, you know, at 110 degrees and started running around and fighting battles and sweating in them. I think down in Mexico, they would call them the death suits.
Max von Sydow was standing there in the desert hot and his fingertips were dripping sweat. And I asked him if he was comfortable and was it all okay? And he said, no, it's absolute hell, but it looks so good, I'll put up with it. And so, you know, that's how they felt about it. All the men had the body they'd never had, you know, they had got muscle suddenly, so they loved it. And I was determined that the still suit was going to be very sexy. There were a lot of sexy clothes in that movie that never hit the screen. Francesca wore a wonderful nightdress. It was dripping in sort of squares and dissolved into silk, and you could see her body. But, I mean, you know, she was shot covered in a cheap cotton sheet, and I could have killed everybody.
A lot of the work that we did, you just don't see. There were costumes that we made which didn't even make it onto the screen.
We made 2,000 costumes with hats.
David decided he didn't want the Fremen to have these headdresses, so they never appeared.
You know, you put all this work into it and a fraction shows, but I think overall you can tell the richness, you know, that there was a lot of work there. So, you know, I feel very proud that I, you know, I worked on it.
Hey guys, it's Lisa with a cool movie extra fact now. Rick Baker is one of the most well-known makeup artists in the film industry. His work has been used in such films as Star Wars, King Kong, The Exorcist, Videodrome, Men in Black, The Ring, and How the Grinch Stole Christmas. But it was his work on An American Werewolf in London which caused the Academy Awards to create a whole new category for makeup effects just so Baker could get his golden statue for his efforts. As of 2018, Baker has won that award 7 times. Do you like my shirt? You can get one for yourself in the shop section under the video.